All right, Shalom, Rastafari. This is Wendem Yadom. This is Ras Yadinos Tesarik of the Line of Jesus Society. This is Wendem Yadom reporting for LOJ Society and broadcasting on Ethiopian World Net on the YouTubes, and also you can join us on Ethiopian World Net at the Facebook. So check the description. Hopefully we have a little bit more information there. Now, we began off the first part. We got a little bit interrupted, but we were speaking about the prophetic signs in 2012 that we see on the horizon. And we had left off speaking about November 2nd, 1930, being that acceptable year of the Lord. So we was about to go to the scriptures, right? And we have to go to Isaiah. Let's go to Isaiah 50. Let's see, Isaiah, actually 60. I think it's 61. Isaiah 60, 61. All right, and we're going to deal with this in English. And for any more clarity, we might go into the Royal Amharic, the Metahaf Kedus of Negus and Neges. And here's one of the new pocket size versions of it, the text of His Majesty. His Majesty's 1961 authorized, revised Amharic Bible, we know as the RAB or the Rab, right? So we call that in the society among the brotherhood the Rab or the revised Amharic Bible, okay? So we're now looking in the Schofield study Bible, the English version, right? And chapter 61 of Isaiah says there are two events. There are two advents, right? Two advents in one view. There are two advents in one view. Now, when we see there's two advents from a Judaic, right? From a Judaic perspective, these two advents, some say there's two messiahs, the Messiah Ben Yosef and the Messiah Ben David, right? Some say, well, Christ came in so-called, not zero A.D., but in the first century, right, of the Common Era, and that he would come again. Some even look for him to come again. True Rastafari say that he has already, Yosef, come again. So it's for I and I, as the sons and daughters, to meet John there. You know what I'm saying? To meet him there. Jah will be waiting there. You know, he will be waiting there. But we have to grow up. But we have to begin, first of all, with his teaching. If we are children. You see, a lot of people say, well, His Majesty do this, His Majesty do that, next thing. But for us, if he's our Father, and moreover, if we say he's I and I, God and King of Kings, it's more important for us to do what he says to do than to just try to do what he does. You understand? If we are to be obedient children and to grow up to him in all things. So let's look at these two advents in one view. Let's actually put this right here. The two advents, right, here we go. The two advents, right? The two advents, right? In one view, right? In one view, right? Two advents in one view. Two comings, right? Two comings, two revelations, two appearances. Now, what are we speaking of here, essentially? From the Ritua Hymenot, or the what we call the Orthodox teaching, right? Let's do this right here. From the Orthodox, right? From the Orthodox teaching. This will be concerning the what? Father, right? The Father and the Son. Now, there's a video that we want to post. We haven't posted it yet, but hopefully within the next couple of hours, we'll have an opportunity to post a video where we are recommending Yoel Natan, some of the books by a Messianic Hebrew brethren, named Yoel Natan. One is the Jewish Trinity, right? There's a free source book, a resource book out there. And there's also Monotheism. I think he has another book on on baptism. There seems to be one on, I think, 666 from a Lutheran eschatological perspective. But the books that we're recommending is The Jewish Trinity and Monotheism, dealing with the whole moon god, you understand, or the Islamic, we put that in the Islamo-fascism, Mohammedan category, because there's a lot of people who say, well, it's all the same thing, but these people have not studied or show themselves approved, so they are not really authorized by truth to really be speaking these things that they're speaking. So people often say, well, the Bible and the Quran and all this is all the same thing. But when you study and show yourself approved to God as a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, you'll recognize how much of an error that is, because ones have not studied to show themselves approved to God. They've studied to show themselves approved to a denomination or a clique of ignorant, like-minded people. We're not to be like that, all right? So anyway, we're going to post that as well, but that kind of like to show that there's a Jewish Trinity, right, or a Judaic Trinity. So when we speak about Selassie, we really have to recognize, well, who and what we're speaking of. In fact, that was another vid that we wanted to touch on Selassie, right, a Selassie video, all right? But let's first of all deal with this acceptable year of the Lord, and let's understand this particular foundation and also what Libya, Egypt, and Ethiopia, all having dramatic and almost cataclysmic changes in 1 year, this 2012. What does the divine, the prophetic word say to us of that? And we might be able to better answer, is it a conspiracy of men and people, or is it a sign or an act of God? Now, how they died or whatever, we don't know. But we know that all of that going on, Egypt, Libya, and now Ethiopia, right, as of August 2012, are showing us signs of God in Christ and revelation of prophecy in this time and space, all right? So the Father and Son, right, the advent, two events in one view, and we're going to just touch on, for right now, we're going to touch on, actually, this is Isaiah. We're going to Isaiah, right? Right here, Isaiah, right? Isaiah 61. And let's speak on verses 1 to 2 for a moment, all right? So, first of all, it says here, Besamah, Wodaman says, Kedusa, Haduam, like it says, the two events in one view, this is the subscription in the Schofield reference, the study Bible. It says, the Spirit of the Lord God. Now, when we see Lord God right there, each of these, this is translated here. But we have to understand from a Hebraic perspective that there is a Hebraic, or what they say, a Jewish Trinity. That the Trinitarian idea or concept is biblical, is scriptural. Even though there's a lot of people out there that will say, no, it's not, because they are misinterpreting outside ideas from whether Hinduism or Eastern religions or other things. You understand? We have to recognize what the role of Israel is and how it's the true God that has revealed to the Beit Israel, or the so-called Jews, that truth. This is why Christ would say in the New Testament that ye worship that which you know not. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. And behold, the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, Moah, Anbesa, Zeim, Negeda, Yehuda. All right? But, you know, it should be the end of the reasoning right there. But there's more truth that we have to uncover and discover. We have to know the truth, and the truth shall set I and I free. Now, the Spirit of Adonai, Yahweh, is upon me, because Yahweh hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty, right? Liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. Verse 2, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, of Yahweh. of Jah, Rastafari, prophetically, we're going to show how that's 1930. All right, so let's put this right here. There is something known as an acceptable, right, acceptable year, right, acceptable year of, let's say, Jah, right? It's an acceptable year of the Lord, of Jah, of Yahweh, of Yah, right? What is that acceptable year? We say that acceptable year is 1930 AD. So the sun, right, the sun came forth to proclaim the Father. You know, there's some folks that be saying, well, if Haile Selassie is God, then why is he praying? Are you unlearned? Do you not know our Ethiopian, the Ritua Hymenote, that the Father communicate praise to the Son and the Son to the Father, and they communicate in the Memphis Caduce? This is why the true knowledge of the Trinity has been woefully confused among the Gentiles. So many coming into Rastafari are bringing in their various ideas from their former religious denominational persuasion. So those who were Catholic might bring in their Catholic ideas. You understand? Those who are Protestant, some of the daughters of Mystery Babylon, will bring in their ideas. Like those who are Jehovah Witness, bring in Jehovah Witness ideas. Those who are Seventh-day Adventists, bring in those ideas. The Evangelicals bring in their ideas. The Pentecostals bring in their ideas. And every one of these daughters of Babylon, you understand? But we're going to the root. This is why these teachings are dealing with the root and the truth of it. It's in the half of the story that has not been told. But in all of these different denominations, and all of these denominations, what's very clear is that they haven't spoken of the truth of we, the black people, the lost sheep of the Beit Israel, nor have they proclaimed the truth of the humanity of Jesus Christos as a Ethiopian or as a black man. Most of them say it doesn't matter what color he is, but they suffer gladly. You'll send another Jesus. Therefore, they will suffer another gospel. Therefore, they suffer another spirit. And they blaspheme the Holy Spirit by calling it a Holy Ghost. Not knowing that a ghost, you know, and the Holy Spirit is two different, you know what I mean? No ghost in that sense is holy, if you understand what a ghost really is. Be that as it may, right? It says down here to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn. Now, there's a break right here where it says the kingdom, peace, and blessing after the day of vengeance anticipated. And he said Isaiah chapter 61 verses 3 to Isaiah 65 verse 24. Then there's a one here says the restoration of Israel. So we're speaking about the restoration, right? The restoration, right? The restoration of, right, Israel. But we have to also recognize what Revelation says. Revelation says there are Jews who call themselves Jews and who are not. This is why when we speak about the black Beta Israel, so many folks are, you know, it sounds astounding. It sounds like we're making something up. Instead of the real truth that somebody has suppressed this half of the story from you. You understand? But we'll clarify that as well as to touch on the true sign of Israel versus the false sign, which all have to do with this year right here, 1948. Now, in Rastafari, we know that there was a prophecy. Some say it was Marcus Garvey, those who are followers of the Rastafari John the Baptist, the Garveyites. They say it was Marcus Garvey who said, "But look to the east for the crowning of a black man. The day of the redemption is here or near." But before him was the African-American Reverend James Morris Webb, who originally proclaimed this, being a Garveyite of that particular organization at the time, before Garvey, like John the Baptist, lost his head. Yosin, he had proclaimed, look to Africa, right, where a black man would be crowned king. In him you will find the Redeemer. Now, in Judaism and in the Bible, if you study it, there's something known as the kinsman redeemer. There's a kinsman redeemer, all right? And we're speaking of the natural. The redeemer of our souls, of our psyches, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christos, or Jesus Christ. But for the physical Israel, right, there would be a redeemer that would purchase them or buy them back or bring them now out of this. Now, we as Israel have to recognize that this is through Kedemawi Haile Selassie, through that throne being the throne of David. You understand the fulfillment of it. But first things first, the Son came forward first, Jesus Christos, and then bearing witness to the word of the Son, Abba. Abba manifested and revealed his spirit in the person of Kedemawi Haile Selassie. You understand? Now, let's just touch on this for a moment, because I know we're touching on this and that, because there's so much disinformation about this, and, you know, and reasoning with different ones and hearing different false doctrines out there that purport themselves to be Rastafari, and it's not based on this Bible, it's not based on this word, it's not based on Tawahido, it's not based on the Ritua Hymenot. Therefore, you have not gone through the door, you have not gone through the gate, but you trying to climb in another way, Yosin, and not through the teaching of His Majesty. There's a warning, my brothers and sisters. All right, so hear this. It says, observe that Jesus, or Yeshua, he suspended the reading of this passage in Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 2. He suspended the passage, the reading of this passage in the synagogue, the Mikurab Zenazareth of Nazareth, in Luke chapter 4, verses 16 to 21, at the comma in the middle of Isaiah 61 and 2. Right? 61 and 2. So we have to study and show ourselves approved. Most people might miss that totally. We would have missed this totally if it were not for these excellent references that explain the Bible based on the Bible. It says that the first advent, therefore, it opened the day of grace. That first advent of the Son, of the Bein Ha Elohim Chayim, the Son of the Living God, it opened the day of grace. Right? It says, then come, it says, quote, the acceptable year of Yahweh or of Jehovah, right? But does not fulfill the day of vengeance, right? The day of vengeance. That will be taken up when Mashiach or Messiah returns. 2 Thessalonians 1, 7 to 10. They say compare with Isaiah 34 and 8. Isaiah 35, 4 to 10. Now it says the last verse, taken with the fourth, it gives the historic connection. The vengeance precedes, right? Precedes the regathering of Israel, the vengeance. And it synchronizes with the day of the Lord. So when they say the day of the Lord, so there's to be a regathering of Israel. There's a vengeance that precedes that. Now, Isaiah chapter 2, verses 10 to 22, Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 to 21, and also Isaiah chapter 63, verses 1 to 6. Now, let's just take a look in Luke chapter 4, verses 16 to 21, and find out what Yeshua HaMashiach, what the Son, said in the synagogue of Nazareth. So we're in chapter 4, verses 16 to 21, right? 16 to 21. Here we go right here. It says, Jesus in the synagogue at Nazareth, and he, Yeshua, Jesus, he came to Nazareth, to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. So he went to his hometown, right, around his homies, so to speak. And as his custom was, this was his custom, this was his habit, right? He went into the synagogue, the Mikurab, on the Shabbat day, on the Senbet day. And he stood up for to read. So he went into the synagogue. And see, if you're not into the, if you don't understand the Judaic root of this, the Hebraic root, and you approach it from Gentile, white, Western conspiracy or confusion, some of this will elude you. He went to the synagogue and went up to the, what we call Aliyah, the Aliyah. He went up to read, right, that particular Torah portion. Now, it's obvious that he was reading from the book of the prophet Esaias, Isaiah. So he was reading what we know as the Haftarah, right, or the prophetical portion of the reading, and not just the Torah. So he was not reading the Torah reading, right, for that day, for that Shabbat, that Sabbath, but he was reading the prophetical reading, which is known as the Haftarah, or the secondary reading, right? It's important for us to understand that. That's why Christ says that ye worship what you know not, but we know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews, or of Judah, Yehuda, right? And we know that salvation is of Moah Anbesa Ze'im Negeda Yehuda, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. Now, here it goes on in verse 17, and says, and there was delivered to him the book of the prophet Esaias, or rather like the roll book, the scroll of the prophet Yeshayahu, or Esaias. And when he had opened the book, in other words, unrolled the roll, he found the place where it was written, verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord, Adonai, is upon me, because he hath anointed me. He has, so what has anointed Yeshua? Understand, what's anointing? Here we have an anointing of the Spirit. Not just anointing of the oil, you understand? But the anointing of the Spirit, all right? He hath anointed me to do what? To preach, to proclaim the Wengel, the good news. Good news to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach, to proclaim deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, it says. Now, if you compare this with where actually it comes from in the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, it's not quite exact the same, but it's the same reference here. There's also something that needs to be said about that, because here it says the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. But when he read it, he said the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Here it says, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the good tidings to the meek. Here it says, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. So we understand that the gospel are good tidings, are good news, the Wengel. As we say, behold the Wengel of the King of Kings, the good news of Kedemawi Haile Selassie. All right, the good news, the gospel, right? Now, he goes on in verse 19, he goes on to say, to preach the acceptable year of Adonai. To preach the acceptable year of Adonai. And then we'll go back to Isaiah chapter 61, verses 2. It says, to proclaim. So preaching is proclamation. All right? Are we getting this? To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, there's a comma right there if you're looking in your Bible. And it says, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn. Right? And there's a semicolon. And then it goes into the kingdom, peace, and blessing. Right? But now, let's check this out in Luke chapter 4, again, 4:19, where we're at, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, capital L, lowercase O-R-D. So that would be, in the Greek, if it's Septuagint, that would be Kurios, and Kurios would correspond to the Hebrew Adoni, you'll send, or in some cases Adonai, which corresponds to the Amharic Geta, right? Geta, we say Geta Yesus, to say Adoni Yeshua, or Adonai Yehoshua. Then it says in verse 20, and he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, or in the Mikorah, the synagogue, like the Gabai, right? The one who ministers that that synagogue, that holy place. And he sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue, the mikorab, as we say, bamarinya, were fastened on him. They all looked at him after he read this, right? And verse 21, and he began to say to them, so he saw all of them looking at him, so he began to say to them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. So remember the word, sound, and power. He said, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears, right? Verse 22, and all bear witness. All said, did you hear what he said? Yeah, I heard that. Say, all bear witness, right? And they wondered at the gracious words. The what kind of words were they? They were gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. So he performed the opening of the mouth. And they wondered at what gracious words, you know, what words of grace proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? They said, isn't this Joseph's son? Isn't this so-and-so's boy? Ain't that so-and-so? Yeah, that's so-and-so's boy, right? Verse 23, and he, Yeshua, Jesus, said to them, ye will surely say to me this proverb, this misale, this mishle, this parabolic myth, or because a proverb is basically a myth, right? A teaching, a verbal teaching tool, or you can paint it out too in characters like a cartoon, like ancient Egypt, so forth and so on. But he said, you will surely, in truth, you're going to say this proverb. To me, you're going to say this proverb. Physician, doctor, right? Heal thyself. Heal yourself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country. In other words, they're going to say to him, remember, he returned to his hometown. You know, remember, it said that he came to his own, but his own received him not. So we see this between the Father and the Son. We see it in Yeshua in the Scripture, and we see this happen also to Kadamawi Haile Selassie. You know, saying that he came to his own, but his own majority overwhelmingly did not receive it. But another people, you know, saying this people in the West, I and I, Rastafari, we have received it, right? But they're going to say, whatever you've done over there, do also in your country. And verse 24, and he said, verily, or amen, amen, I say to you, amen, I say to you, no prophet, no Nabi is accepted in his own country, in his hometown. Verse 25, but I tell you of a truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, or Eliyahu, which is, say, Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine was throughout all the land. Interesting, because they say that, oh, there was a famine in Ethiopia, and it was His Majesty's fault. It was Haile Selassie's fault. Isn't this very interesting? Overstand this word of Yeshua right here, right? But, verse 26, to none of them was Elijah, if you please, sent, save to Sarepta, a city of Sidon, to a woman that was a widow. Right? Verse 27, and many lepers, right? Many lepers, one who had skin diseases, right, were in Israel in the time of Eliseus, or really this is Elisha here. That's the Greek of Elisha, Eliseus, the prophet. And none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman, the Syrian. Wow. What does this mean? Why did Yeshua say that to them? So verse 28, where he stopped speaking, it says, and all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Wow. Wow. Now, can somebody express, and have you read that before? Have you thought about that? He's explaining to them the truth, basically. Right? He says, they're going to say to him, physician, heal thyself, and whatever we heard you do in Capernaum, if you did this over here for these folks, you need to do this for your own country. Right? And speaking about for Nazareth. You know what I'm saying? We call today a city, but then they refer to it as a country. Each province was like a country. But be that as it may, then he makes this statement here, and it says that when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Why were they upset about this? Well, what did Yeshua say? He said that no prophet is accepted in his own country. That's like saying that sometimes when you speak this to your own family, flesh and blood, that is, they don't really get it, right? It's like what it says here. He says that there were many widows. There were many widows that were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens, they were shut up for 3 years and 6 months. And notice this, 3 years and 6 months, that's approximate same amount of time that Scripture and history records that Yeshua was ministering. You know what I'm saying? That's the same amount of time that he preached and he was in his ministry for 3.5 years. But in the time of Elias, that the heavens were shut up and there was a great famine throughout all the land, but to none of them was Elias sent. In other words, he wasn't sent to any of them, only to Sarepta, a city of Sidon, and to a woman that was a widow. So there were other widows in that time. So why were they getting upset? Because Jah chooses as he pleases. You understand? People always say, well, if he's God, and if that's so, then why was this, and why was that, and why this, and why that, so forth and so on. Well, you're saying that, listen, there was a lot of widows there in the time of Elijah, who was a mighty prophet, known as a mighty prophet of Yahweh, of God, and yet there was only this one widow in Sarepta, a city of Sidon, that the prophet was sent to. In other words, she survived, her son survived, even in a time of famine, and other people, you understand? God's messenger wasn't. So it's saying that God chooses, you understand? He chooses as he pleases. You know, we always say, well, how come there was a famine? If Haile Selassie was God, as you say, or King of Kings, or all of this, then how come there was a famine? How come such and such? And how come? See, don't approach it as a foolish Gentile. See, a Gentile even has more mercy because they don't know these things. You understand? We should know these things if we say we are his children, we are his people, we are Beit Israel. That's why you have to study and show yourself approved. All right? Then he uses another example. There was many lepers. So there were widows and there were lepers in Israel, Yovas. And that none of them were cleansed. So all of them died in their filthy leprosy, except for Naaman the Syrian. Now, when those around who had said, wow, what gracious words, isn't this Joseph's boy, this is Joseph's son, so when they heard this, they were angry. You see how the word does people? Yovas, because it hit upon a truth, illness, illachikwalo. 29, it says, and they said they rose up, these people, and thrust him out of the city. You got to get out of here. You can't be talking like that, right? And they led him to the brow of a hill. They were going to throw him off of the cliff just because he was speaking the truth, but they didn't like it. You see how these church folks are, how these so-called religious folks can be, right? They wasn't spiritual, but they were religious. They were like the church folks today, right? Whereon their city was built, that they might cast him down headlong, to show you the evil they had. And remember, just a couple of moments before, this could be a lesson on watching compliments. Don't get too caught up by flattery. Oh, you're wonderful. You teach so well. Yeah, you my prophet. Oh, you my, what's the other one? You my priest or something like that. No, learn to prophesy. Learn to speak the prophetic word. You understand? In other words, learn what the prophecy is. You understand? So you will speak prophecy. You understand? Because it's more to speak prophecy than to speak in a tongue. Because, you know, to speak in a tongue takes some practice and, you know, maybe a little bit more so. You understand? But to speak prophetically means that you have the Spirit. That you can read this word and see what it really means. You understand? But that, both of those are gifts of God. Verse 30 says, but he, Yeshua, passing through the midst of them, what did he do? He went his way. It's like they couldn't touch it. You understand? But now here's what's so very interesting. When we talk about the acceptable year of the Lord, we say that this acceptable year in prophecy is 1930. You understand? The coronation of Haile Selassie. Alright, the coronation of Haile Selassie I. Alright? And this is that acceptable year of the Lord. Now, we know that the first part was fulfilled, you understand, when it says right here that the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, truly the Spirit of the Lord God was and is upon I and I in Yeshua, because the Lord hath anointed me. So who anointed Yeshua HaMoshiach? You see, in Ethiopia, there were these religious controversies about when did Christ really become Christ, and was it the Hulet Ledet? Was it Source Ledet? Was it Kibbat? And these things caused a lot of dissension to the point that people were arguing with each other religiously. This is after the Catholics came in and brought in these diverse doctrines too. But they were arguing with each other incessantly, and many Ethiopians were killed over these sort of things. Now, here's what's so interesting, right? Because we got the same thing going on. If they only had read the Metzav Kedus, you know what I'm saying? You hear about these religious denominations, these doctrines, and so on, but ones don't know the word. You see, that's where the devil comes in, when you don't know the word. You understand? Because it says that the Lord hath anointed me to do what? To preach good tidings to the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance. Can I tell you that 9/11 is interesting, the day. It seemed like 9/11 is Ethiopia's New Year. And moreover, when you really start to look at the 9/11, you understand, it seems to come into this day of the Lord, or day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. Now, if we read on, verse 3, it says, now verse 3 is the second part. So we have the first part from 61, verse 1, to the comma in verse 2, right, which is pertaining to the Son. Now, the first part, or pertaining to the Father now, when we go from after the comma, where it says, and this is Isaiah 61, verse 2, it says, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn. Now it's speaking about the kingdom, peace, and the blessing, right? That's after the day of vengeance, which is anticipated. And it speaks about the restoration of the Beta Israel, the lost black sheep, right? It says, verse 3, it says, to appoint to them that mourn in Sion, to give to them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of Isis, the garment of Miskana, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called, right? So all this is being done so that they might be called, that they might be proclaimed, that they might be called what? Trees of righteousness. The planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Verse 4, and they shall bind the old waste places. They shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. Verse 5, and strangers, right? Strangers, that they're not black Jews, not we as Hebrews, but Gentiles. As there's many Gentiles in Rastafari. And the questions are really mounting on, well, what do we say concerning the Gentiles? Can a white man, can white people be Rastafari? And what's their role? Let's listen up. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. And the sons of the alien, not speaking about us as Ethiopian Hebrews, but speaking about the Europeans and the Anglo-Americans and even the other nations, including some so-called African Hamites, right? The sons of the alien shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. But ye shall be named, we shall be named what? Priests of the Lord. So how can I, even as a brethren, even with what I know of this word, seeking to teach and communicate, how can I be your priest? We're supposed to be, we are all supposed to be a kingdom of the priesthood. You see, taking a shortcut gives a deep scar. And this is why we're going through what we're going through. It's not about what they're doing. It's about what we're not doing, brothers and sisters. You understand? The first thing we're not doing, and that has not been done in Rastafari in a very long time, is us seriously studying and showing ourselves approved to God, to the one who we call God, all right? And to his standard of righteousness, which is Gitachinam et Hanatachin Jesus Christos, Yeshua HaMoshiach, our black Lord and Savior. It says, but ye shall be named the priest of the Lord, of Yahweh. Men shall call you the ministers, the what? The ministers of our God. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? Are Ethiopians Gentiles? No. There might be Gentiles among the Ethiopians, but Ethiopians are not Gentiles. Not those Ethiopians of like Al-Kidan. No, they're not Gentiles. They are covenant people. That's why they're going through what they're going through. They don't understand it because they've forgotten. They are careless. They are willingly forgetful. If they will look at what the covenant states are, the blessings and the curses, which is this Torah portion, a major theme of this Torah portion, the 47th Torah portion, Re'eh, which means, and that whole, behold, look and see, here it is, the Re'eh, you understand, the vision, you understand, the revelation. It says that men shall call us ministers of our God. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles. That means the Anglo, Europeans, all of those who took our and I people into captivity. You see, the script is being flipped. Because they flipped it upside down, and now the King of Kings and Christ is turning right side up. What we have to do is to read and study and accept it and act on what we claim is I and I faith. Otherwise, we are fake if we don't act on that. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles. Wow. So all this, you know, they say they're storing up the money, they're going to little islands. Listen, the wealth of the rich, of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. You know what I'm saying? If we are truly in covenant and recognize our divine heritage right here, you understand? I and I keep I and I shalom. I and I keep I and I peace. You don't have to be tossed and turned by every sleight of hand, little doctrine, because either it matches the truth, the testimony of the King of Kings, the teaching of the Word of God in Christ, or it does not. You understand? It doesn't matter who brings, you know, forget a face, like, just because, oh, yeah, I like this brethren, and yeah, well, he might be wrong here, but he's a good brethren. You don't know what you're saying. You're talking crazy. Even if I and I go outside this word, I should be rebuked. If you love me, otherwise you don't. You see me going the wrong way, you don't want to say nothing. That means you have another kind of heart, not a heart of the sons and the daughters of the King of Kings in Christ. Right? So it says that we're going to eat the riches of the Gentiles. You really need to meditate on that. But most folks don't know who the Gentiles are, because a lot of Negroes, blacks, and coloreds have been told that they are Gentiles, instead of the fact that they are lost sheep of the Beit Israel. So when they read this word, they may know this word, but they don't know who they are. You understand? They're talking about the other Israel instead of the true Israel, who they be. But this is ignorance. My people perish because of a lack of knowledge. You understand? That's what people say. Oh, it don't matter if Jesus is black. It don't matter what color he is. Because they want to keep you in a lack of knowledge so they can eat your blessing. Instead of you eating, as John says, we are to eat. Eat the riches of the Gentiles. And in their glory, in what? In their glory, shall ye boast yourself. Chant, Rastafari. I mean, have you really read this word? I mean, do you really read this word, my brothers and sisters? It says right here, for your shame, ye shall have double. Are we seeing double? For our what? For our shame. You know, the verses in Revelation, it says, reward them double for how they have served us. Excuse me, brothers and sisters, just have to drink a little bit of Buna. That's coffee. You know, coffee was discovered in Ethiopia, too. You know what I'm saying? That's interesting. But anyway, you know, for your shame, for the shame that black and brown and lost sheep have gone through. What does it say right here? For your shame, ye shall have what? Double, right? The two truths, the double, right? The double trouble for Babylon. And for confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess the double. Wait, hold up a moment. In our what? In our land. That's why they try to keep us distracted. That's why they try to keep us disorientated. You know what disoriented means? Not looking to the east. They want us to look this way and that way. And, oh, the election's coming. Oh, what is Obama doing? Oh, what about Romney? You know, instead of looking at what's really going on over there. You understand? Instead of really looking in the right direction. You understand? Because it says right here, therefore in their land, they shall possess the double. Everlasting, eternal joy shall be to them. It's speaking about I and I in this prophetic time, if we receive it. You understand? For I, Yahweh, love judgment. So stop all this peace and love crap. John says he loves what? Judgment. Judgment. You understand? Since when did Rastafari stop talking about judgment? When he started to compromise, you know what I'm saying? When they don't recognize, you know, you put the cart before the horse. You put the Gentile, let the Gentiles come in Rastafari and flip the script. When Haile Selassie talk about unto the color of a man's skin, so forth and so on, they now come in and say, well, you have to accept me if I'm a white Rasta, and let me tell you what to do, because I look like Cesar Borgia. Watch it. For real, watch it. But it's not really their fault so much. It's really your fault. It's I and I's fault because we haven't said, hey, wait, you're a stranger to this. You understand? What? You're a son of an alien. So let's show you if you want to be in this, let's show you what way you belong according to the word. It's grace still. I mean, they could just be destroyed like the rest of them who don't want to submit to the truth of the King of Kings and his Christ, right? But it says, for I, Yahweh, he who is who he is, he who be who he be, His Imperial Majesty, love judgment. I hate robbery for a burnt offering. Wow, that almost reminds me of like what goes on with the Aishans. The Gentiles making enough money off of the Aishans, off of the so-called weed, the wisdom weed, marijuana, and everything. And I still, you know, belly dead sanga. You understand? But, you know, robbery. Robbery for what? Robbery for burnt offerings, right? That's what it says right here. Are you reading this word? You understand? You have to see this for yourself. If you got eyes to see, then look at this word for yourself. Isaiah chapter 61, we're at verse 8. And I will direct their work in truth. Be'ilnet. Ilnet. Yovas? Ilnet. Those who have eyes to see, ears to hear will pick up on it. There's no need to brag or boast. We boast in Jah, Rastafari. It says, I will direct their work in truth, and I will make an eternal covenant with them. How long is an eternal covenant? You understand? How long is an everlasting? It ever lasts. It lasts forever. You understand? Verse 9, it says, and their seed, their race, and then this true black race, this righteous African, Ethiopian, shall be known among the Gentiles. They didn't know about Rastafari among the Gentiles and their offspring among the people. All that see them shall acknowledge them, that they are the seed, that they are the race. Understand that word seed means race, right? The race which the Lord, which Yahweh, he who be, who he be, has blessed. See, there's some folks even in Rastafari that are trying to undermine your blessing, my people, Yovas, and we got to speak up on this, all right? Some of them might just not know any better. Some of them might know better. You understand? Regardless of whether they know, it's the word that's going to show who's who. Because some people are going to be off-ended. You understand? They're going to be off, and they're going to be ended, right? But verse 10 says, I will greatly rejoice in Yahweh. I and I must greatly rejoice in he who be, who he be, in his imperial majesty. My soul shall be joyful in my God, in Amlake, in Elohai, right? For he hath clothed me with the garment of salvation, with Yeshua, our black Lord and Savior. All right? He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. You all right? Yeshua HaMoshiach. As a what? As a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, with jewels, right? And as a bride adorneth herself with jewels. All right? Verse 11 says, for as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God, Adonai Yahweh, Geta Egezi Av Her Lotu Sephat, will cause righteousness and praise, Isis, to spring forth before all the nations. So it doesn't surprise us that there are Rastafari in every nation. But what is really surprising, brothers and sisters, you know what I'm saying, the children of I and I people, is that y'all don't know what your role and responsibility is in this, because instead of obeying the teachings of His Majesty and studying the Bible, you know what I'm saying, you're listening to men and people. You understand? And you're being undermined. Your blessing is being undermined. It's already there. It's already here. But if we don't recognize it, you understand? If we don't recognize it, we lose it. It's like if you don't use it, you lose it. You understand? My brothers and sisters, I know we went a little bit further than this, but these two events, these two advents must be looked at in one view. You understand? And this is a very interesting chapter. We just went through chapter 61, though we mainly focused on verses 1 to 2 right here. It was not our original message, you understand, but we started out right there. Hopefully we'll be able to deal with the next part of the message. My brothers and sisters, Shalom Rastafari. Stay tuned, more to come.